Hi, I'm LadyJenevia. Today's video is a spoiler review of The Boys Season 3, Episode 8. I think I've narrowed down one or two extra videos I will do about the show after this video, and then we can go back into hibernation until Season 4, since I've got other series and films I want to make videos on, but had to push back because of Season 3. So keep an eye out for those. I mentioned in my spoiler-free review about this episode that right from the beginning, watching it is stressful because the episode opens with Homelander finding Ryan, with the help of Victoria, by the way. I didn't know if Aunt Grace was about to get got. I didn't know if some sort of physical harm was going to come to Ryan. That scene was just very tense, and the fact that this was only the beginning of this episode and it just kept escalating, my blood pressure doesn't deserve this much stress. So I'm perfectly fine with it being time for a hiatus. Let me have my R&R before I re-enter the universe of The Boys. But what I did find fascinating about this first scene between Homelander and Ryan was that Homelander promised Ryan he would love him no matter what, and insisted to Ryan that what happened to Becca was an accident. I was taken aback by this because those two things on their own weren't completely terrible moves for him to make as a parent. Who knew that Homelander had even 1% of parenting instincts? This is a man who threw his child off of a roof to try to get him to fly. The bar for Homelander's parenting skills isn't just on the floor. The bar is in the deepest, darkest crevices of the ocean where all those scary fish monsters live. Obviously, I don't agree with everything he's teaching Ryan, but the fact that he could get anything even remotely correct was a shock to me. Like I said, Victoria was the one to help Homelander because she is what? A politician with aspirations for the White House. No wonder she does nothing but hop from one evil deed to the next. She's training for all the war crimes she will enact so she can be just like her predecessors in the White House. I mentioned in my spoiler-free review that this was the episode where inquiring minds would finally get a bit more clarity about what's going on with Victoria. I fully expect her to be a more central big bad in season 4. This season, she was still bad news, but it was a lot more of just building and introducing who she is, how she operates, and so on and so forth. I had refrained from mentioning this specific reference until now because I didn't want to show Victoria's hand too soon. I wanted all of you to see what she does, how far she will go, and how truly depraved of a person she is before I started drawing parallels to real-life political matters. But now, let's just make it clear. Victoria Newman is a stand-in for AOC. Now, for those of you naive enough to think that AOC is an ally to the masses, I'm going to see if I can find the thread and I will link it in the description box, but she is CIA. She ran on a campaign completely lying about her background to try to make herself seem like she was just one of the people. No, she's CIA. She's a Fed. Name one thing that AOC has ever done to make an actual necessary change in legislation or policy that has benefited the masses. She's doing horrifically tone-deaf photo shoots at the border instead of getting anything done in DC. She's wearing a hideous dress to the Met Gala that says tax the rich, which is a nasty defanging of the real expression, which is eat the rich. Simply taxing the rich does nothing to get to the root of the issue of the systemic violence that has to happen in order for people to be able to accumulate that much wealth in the first place. Wages that are absurdly low while the elites that AOC is friends with can pocket the profits? Absolutely not. You know, if you actually start to pay attention to various political ongoings in countries in the global south, you'd be surprised by how much people can actually get done. When I say people, I mean the people, not performative neoliberal establishment politicians. You know, the people of Chile protested for years and were able to get important amendments done to their constitution. Amendments that were necessary because the old constitution was from the Pinochet regime. By the way, you know who was allied with Augusto Pinochet? The US government. You know who was allied with Salvador Allende? The Soviet Union. Or what about the nationwide protests happening right now in Ecuador against Guillermo Lasso's austerity policies? Now, if you're looking at me right now with giant question marks floating around your cranium, you're probably listening to the wrong news outlets. You have to actually go out of your way in order to find and follow anti-imperialist news sources, journalists, commentators, and so on and so forth. if you want to know what's really going on all over the world. I'm aware I'm on a tangent, so let me circle back around. You're going to have a year or so off before the new season of The Boys airs, which leaves you plenty of time to read up on how AOC is a fed before season 4, when Victoria Newman will presumably take center stage, so you will hopefully feel better equipped to pick up on the subtext and commentary of her story in that season. I hope they have Victoria wear an ugly dress to a rich people party with a tacky, defanged political slogan painted on it. Considering how lopsided season 3 was at calling out war criminals when it comes to which political party they're from, even though the war criminals are in both major parties, I don't know if I really trust season 4 to make Victoria's material tackle its real world equivalent as well as I would like for them to, but at least give me a couple of references to go on a tangent about if and when I review that season. So now let's talk about some of the smaller characters from this episode, specifically in regards to who was smaller in their amount of airtime in this episode, as well as the season overall. First up, Ashley. I was shocked when Homelander told her to take off the wig. Not necessarily surprised that he was being deranged and cruel, but just that we had been seeing these glimpses for over a season now of her hair falling out or her pulling her hair out. And with everything else going on that is so much larger in scale of drama and action and shock value for the sake of it, yes, that is shade about the deep. I didn't really think about what those hair moments were building up to, but I like that we finally got to see a bit more nuance develop for her as a character. I do still think that she's out for herself more often than not, but I like that she was able to have just a couple of moments of humanity, things like apologizing to Maeve before she is rendered unconscious, and her deleting the footage at the end that showed that Maeve survived. I haven't changed my stance where I believe that Ashley will only jump ship from Vought because she reaches a point of seeing that the company is going down and she decides to find a high-ranking corporate gig elsewhere. But if we're going to have her getting more airtime on the show, it's important to develop her beyond just this one-note energy she has of being intense and a company woman first and foremost. Next, the deep.
Oh Lord. Again. Nothing new, nothing changed, same old shit. Same old fucking shit.
Next, A-Train. I will be very curious to see if this becomes a turning point in A-Train's larger story across the series in its entirety, because he has been so desperate to fit into the Seven, to be a team player, so he will be able to reap the benefits of being in this famous superhero team. But that scene showed that there is no team. There is Homelander and the people who follow him out of fear or desperation. A-Train learned that Black Noir has been killed. Homelander knows all of the bad or shameful things the people in that room are trying to hide. Is that really the life you want to live, A-Train? You don't have any friends in that room. You don't have any allies. It's just nothing but danger and misery in that room. Supersonic tried to get A-Train on board. He offered A-Train a way out, and A-Train burned it to the ground, and now he's stuck with Homelander, the Deep, and Ashley. How's that working out for you? I never thought I would say this going into a new season of The Boys, but when it comes to season 4, I'm really looking forward to seeing what comes next for A-Train. The one other point I want to make about A-Train's material in this episode is about that argument he had with his brother. I completely understand that his brother would feel inclined to lash out at A-Train because he had just experienced an extremely traumatic injury, which he will have to live with for the rest of his life. I'm not claiming that he won't be able to still live a full life, but the trauma of the injury and having to adjust to this new state of being, it's a lot to experience and process, which he's not been able to work through just yet because it just happened. However, the idea that he would be mad at A-Train for taking out Blue Hawk, and more specifically saying that he wanted his children to see Blue Hawk arrested, see his mugshot, what an asinine writing choice. Can we just look at the thousands upon thousands of cases of police brutality against Black and brown people and tell me how many times the cops faced any form of legal consequences for it, let alone served actual prison time? Blue Hawk was a cop for one of the most powerful corporations in the world, and we're supposed to believe that A-Train's brother would genuinely believe that this man would have faced any legal consequences for his actions and had a mugshot taken. Don't be ridiculous. That whole exchange, the general vibe and tone of it, it really made me think that the creative voices behind the show were trying to make us feel, as the audience, that A-Train was the one that was in the wrong. No, absolutely not. What type of counter-revolutionary psyop garbage is this? A-Train did nothing wrong. I've never liked A-Train more than when he dragged that fascist. The single most satisfying thing I have ever seen him do. And you rich counter-revolutionaries creating this show will never manipulate me into thinking A-Train was the bad guy for how he avenged his brother and he avenged his entire neighborhood. Let's skip over now quickly to the now ex-members of the Seven and focus on the fact that they'll presumably be gone from the show now. It feels needlessly cruel to finally give Black Noir a backstory, only to immediately get rid of him in the next episode. I really wish that the writers, when deciding they wanted to remove a character permanently from a piece of media, would make sure to get you attached earlier and give the audience more time to live in that level of attachment and emotional investment in the character and understanding more about them fully before they're taken out. I'm not saying that Black Noir didn't already have fans before his animated backstory being aired last week. I'm only saying that I think it would have had more impact overall if you had given me more time as a viewer to think that Black Noir was going to have a chance of fighting back against Soldier Boy and defeating him before he was tragically taken out before he could even do that. I just learned who he really was, and now he's gone. Maeve is also out of the Seven now, and to be quite honest, this was the right move. The creative higher-ups of this show demonstrated for this entire season that they had no idea what to do with her as a character. Now, me personally as a viewer, I would have loved to see her still around and be part of this fight. But if you can't do the character justice and you can't give the actress anything interesting to do, set them free. At the very least, Maeve is still alive, so if they'd like to bring her back at some point for a cameo or a subplot that is worth her time, then a conversation can be had. I'll talk more about Maeve's material that leads up to the end, but I wanted to more so address the departure of these members. I have been reiterating all throughout my season 3 reviews that the ensemble was too crowded, the stories and character arcs were being stretched too thin, and regardless of me liking these two characters, it was ultimately the right move to make some cuts. I don't think anyone is surprised that I would also add that if it were me in charge, I would have cut the deep. He would have been first on the chopping block. No questions asked. I kind of hope they don't try to add more new members to the Seven in season 4. The ensemble is already packed. Homelander got his ego boosted like never before, so I cannot imagine him wanting to maintain the old system when it could just be the Homelander show with people who are willing to do his bidding, be his sidekicks, or just featured players, and so on and so forth. One small thing I want to mention, and I don't have a neat way to put it in with any of my other talking points of this review, there's a part of this review where MM invokes the name of Mother Teresa. And maybe we could just not do that. She's not someone I've read up on as much as some of the war criminals I have had a fair few words for during my reviews of this season, but it really doesn't take much effort to look her up and find a lot of critical points about her and her work. If she was so great at fundraising donations for people who were poor, sick, and in need, why exactly were hypodermic needles being reused on sick patients under her care, including those suffering from HIV during the height of the AIDS crisis? I am imploring the people who make this show to do even 5 minutes of searching on DuckDuckGo before name-dropping some of these historical figures. And yes, I said DuckDuckGo, because not everyone wants all of their internet searches to be sold off for the highest profit. But one thing I will say though is this time around, MM was wearing a Tupac shirt, and now we're getting back on track. Instead of putting a picture up of the number one president of drone strikes, it is much better to put a spotlight on a legacy Black Panther. And yes, Tupac came from a family of Black Panthers. If you don't know about his family, or especially if you don't know about his aunt, Asata Shakur, look her up, read about her. The late great activist Yuri Kochiyama was friends with Asata, by the way. Anyway, if you want to learn more about Tupac, just read this book. By the way, it was still very weird to watch those Homelander stans still screaming at a protest at the beginning of this episode about Annie. Let's just leave that terrible subplot behind in season three, shall we? You're gonna have some time to do some research before making season four. You have time to learn not to give good PR to a war criminal on your very popular show. Huey was experiencing some ear goo, so I am curious about whether or not the show will choose to have any recurring health complications for him, though obviously not to the same degree of severity as Butcher. I mentioned in an earlier review this season that I think Butcher needs to die in battle, and now you all have a bit more context to my thoughts on that. He's now been given a ticking clock because he took too much temp fee, even after he knew it would lead to exactly that. They can just time the remaining season or seasons to coincide with Butcher using the remaining time he has to finish his quest of destroying Homelander and Vought, and by extension saving billions of people's lives. Also, him knocking Huey out to stop him from coming along on the mission, that works as a sort of foreshadowing for him to have Huey be a central figure in his final heroic act whenever the show ends to save Huey and by extension save the world. Huey was much better in this episode, as you all probably know. He gave Annie all the space to rightly say, "I told you so." He still believes in Butcher, which I don't really agree with, but it's cute that he's back to being innocent enough to be the only one who still believes in Butcher. I have been waiting for this man to apologize to Annie more or less all season, and ultimately it's all part of that important reminder that Huey's greatest strength is his heart. He had a choice to make at the end of the episode of either taking temp fee because Annie was in danger, or lifting her up, figuratively speaking, so she could quite literally lift herself up. It was cute. Love transformed into energy, which in turn gives Annie the ability to fly. I'll be intrigued to see if she starts to retain that ability to fly, even when she's not being boosted by a building full of electricity. Also, the fact that when Maeve escapes, Annie is the one she calls, and then as soon as she sees Huey again, Maeve tells him,
"It's like you wear a neon sign that says, raw dog me, I'm a bottom.
I'm gonna let you two catch up."
I don't have the words for how funny that was to watch, specifically because of all the things she could have said to him, that would not have even been in my top 100 guesses. All kidding aside though, when Maeve told Annie that her hashtag got every LGBT teen to hassle Vought, which as a result helped Maeve to find a way to escape, clearly it's invoking the Free Britney movement. Somehow this is coming up in conversation again, first with my Elvis review and now this review. It's clearly something that's very prevalent in the cultural zeitgeist, that it's running parallel to so many works of art being released right now. Now, I don't know about all of you, but for me, the drama of Maeve betraying the main good guys of this show to team up with Butcher and Soldier Boy, I was completely fine with it because it all led us to the point of finally getting to see Maeve fight Homelander. I have been waiting to see this since season one. I have wanted so badly for her to just get him. And when I was watching this episode for the first time and I was taking notes on what was happening in the episode and my initial reactions to those things, when she started fighting him, I wrote in my notes, "Rip his face off, Maeve." And that would have been some nasty Hellraiser content, but if she had gotten that far, I still would have cheered her on because she would have done what needs to be done. Now it's time for an interlude about rom-coms, because Frenchie gave a shout out to 27 dresses. The only way him doing that could have been better is if he had immediately started drunkenly singing Benny and the Jets with incorrect song lyrics. Shake, lose a limb, gonna make a feather. It figures that the only corner of this show that seems to have any understanding of or appreciation for romance would be the corner where Kimchi is. Classic MGM musicals, Katherine Heigl rom-coms, we're really running the gamut here. Also, it feels like another reminder that we need Meg Ryan to appear on The Boys and remind everyone of the supremacy of the Hollywood rom-com. Do you think Jack Quaid has ever seen Kate and Leopold? Imagine if your mother was in Kate and Leopold. Truly, these Nepo babies are really out here living the life.
Oh, stop it, please! No more! Stop, please! I beg you, I'm tired. Can you go away?
But while we're here, should we talk a bit about Kimchi? Should we talk about Kimiko smacking some sense into Frenchie? It was giving me Edna mode, pull yourself together energy, and that's what I'm sitting front row to see. But then that moment finally came where she called him mon coeur. She said, and I quote, I see mon coeur. Excuse me? Does that sound platonic to you? Eat your heart out, Eric Kripke.
Eat your heart out.
Frenchie was providing so much emotional support for Kimiko all the way from when they first met, and now she's putting that back onto him, so he is finally able to stand up to Butcher. And Kimiko's little smile when Frenchie is finally telling Butcher off, we have all been waiting to see it, and it was worth the wait. I just love how, no matter what nonsense so many of these characters are doing on this show, Kimchi seem to find themselves off in their own little pocket of this universe, doing their own thing, such as giving your boyfriend a self-love pep talk and later breaking into a Vought lab to make Soldier Boy knockout gas. Truly, Kimchi are still the superior couple, confirmed. And Kimiko getting to do a Flashdance homage while violently tearing up cops with her bare hands. That was a moment for the history books. I love seeing her happy and thriving. But we're really getting a mishmash of 1980s material, aren't we? Muddled messaging about the feds funding fascism all over the world, while also perpetuating the same Red Scare propaganda that many believe was just a facet of the Cold War in the past, but really, Red Scare propaganda has never stopped being churned out, especially by Hollywood. Even the Soldier Boy storyline for this season gets partially wrapped up by blaming the explosion on the Russians. What an odd creative choice that completely lacks self-awareness. So you made this entire season where you're perpetuating Russophobic propaganda by spreading anti-Soviet propaganda with Soldier Boy's awful backstory, but then you're having your show's evil corporation make up a lie in which they blame a bad thing on the Russians that Russians had absolutely no part in. Are you doing okay over there? Do you need a nap? Do you need a shorter workday? If so, maybe you should stop doing Red Scare propaganda that undermines the efforts of the workers of the world to unite to get you better working conditions. But hey, it's apparently the 1980s, so at least we can get a fun 1980s pop culture reference, like the Flashdance soundtrack. Now, if you really wanted to win me over with a 1980s reference, though, you would have had someone on that show say that Grease 2 is the superior Grease film, because it's true. Speaking of 1980s, though, did anyone catch when Soldier Boy was talking about being at the Oscars and his film losing, and he says that he... Jane Wyman? Do any of you know who that is? The first wife of Ronald Reagan. The layers to this? What do I even say about it? You're not just calling out Reagan's policies in this season, you're calling out his ex-wife. Wow. And before any of you try to act like, oh, poor her, it's not her fault that her ex is evil, she voted for him twice and heavily praised him when he died, which is not exactly the approach I would have taken if my ex turned into that.
Isn't that a pretty horrible thing to say when her funeral's going on right now?
Too bad, too bad.
But I have to say, I appreciated the shout out to An American in Paris, because even though the story of that film hasn't aged well, it's still a fantastic film. The George Gershwin songs, the 17-minute ballet number, Georges Guettari's voice, Oscar Levant's one-man orchestral performance, and of course, the one and only Gene Proletariat Kelly. And that's not me projecting. Gene Kelly himself said that he represented the proletariat. He was a child of the Great Depression, and he did not like to make fancy clothes a part of his image because he wanted to be an artist for the people and not for the elites. He also opposed the HUAC. He was an absolute legend, and if Chris Evans does not do dance training for 6 to 8 hours a day for a few months to play him, or if he attempts in any way to capitalist wash Gene Kelly, I will square up against Chris Evans personally. The Boys as a show could not have shouted out a better legend of the golden age of Hollywood musicals. I love Gene Kelly, and Vincente Minnelli was also an iconic director. But of course, this mention was taking place when Soldier Boy was monologuing his backstory. And I have to really give it up to Jensen Ackles. He delivers these moments really well. And it's just a shame that they didn't give him more opportunities to expand on what we did get to see from him this season. And maybe it's my own fault for expecting a lot out of what they were going to do with the character and with Jensen as a performer, but it feels like a lot of underdeveloped potential. For example, we find out during this monologue that Soldier Boy has a whole lot of his own daddy issues. He did all of this, the Compound V trials, getting his own powers, in order to try to impress his father, but it was never good enough. He quotes his father with lines like, a real man wouldn't have cheated, or that he took a shortcut. And this immediately comes back within this same episode where he tells Homelander more or less the exact same thing and he calls him a disappointment the way his own father said to him. And I just can't help as though I would have preferred if you'd put that first monologue Jensen did a little bit earlier in this season and then tricked us into thinking he might learn a little something from being in modern times, only for him to give us a twist when he finally meets Homelander, and then he would tell Homelander that Homelander is a disappointment. It would also make for a funny parallel of lacking in self-awareness, kind of like how Homelander is berating Ashley, the Deep, and A-Train and tells them, Noir was worth more than all of you put together. As if Homelander wasn't the one to take out Noir in the first place, how are you going to be antagonistic to your team as if it's their fault when you're the one who killed him? Weirdo. It just feels like there's this recurring whiplash of things taking a turn more quickly than would be ideal in the overall pacing of this story, because you've got too many things happening and too many characters. Soldier Boy doesn't feel great about how his father treated him, and then boom, immediately repeating that same treatment to Homelander. I would have preferred more of a gap in how long of a wait we have from that backstory to him passing on the generational trauma. It's just my preference. But this fight is really what's been built up to for this entire season. It's a lot of people trying to fight Soldier Boy at different stages. Sometimes it's Butcher fighting him, sometimes it's Annie fighting him. It really felt like a relay race, you know, tag, you're in, it's your turn to throw some punches at the big supervillain, with the other fight, of course, happening nearby between Homelander and Maeve. I might not talk about this fight quite as much because I'm trying to save a few of my talking points about Soldier Boy to reiterate and elaborate on a bit more in a separate video. Just going through my thoughts on how the character was done this season and just aggregating them into one place instead of across all these different videos. I do have an array of feelings about how they used Ryan in this fight. On the one hand, I really liked that moment of Butcher and Maeve looking at each other after Ryan lasered Soldier Boy, and them having that mutual understanding that even though they were very set in their ways of wanting to use Soldier Boy as a weapon to destroy Homelander, that quest is ultimately not as important as saving this child who is now in the line of fire. Ryan being in this scene is also a good way of emphasizing this idea of toxic masculinity existing as intergenerational trauma. We just had Soldier Boy reveal context about his own father, and then you follow that through to Homelander and then to Ryan. That through line from Homelander to Ryan is also even more evident at the end of the episode with what happens at the rally, but I will get to that particular development in the story a little bit later. I think another reason why it's important for Ryan to be in this scene is because if we had that moment where Soldier Boy rejects Homelander without Ryan there, there would definitely be some people who would just laugh and enjoy seeing someone stick it to Homelander. It would probably be a mix, to be fair. You would have the people who will lean into the dramatic performance of Antony Starr and connect to him playing this scene very seriously and the pain that Homelander feels at this rejection. And then there are those of us who really don't care about the feelings of fascists and would laugh and gloat at him being rejected by his boomer war criminal father. Though, if we're being pedantic, Soldier Boy is not a boomer, he's much older than that, but that's neither here nor there. With Ryan being there, it magnifies the emotional fallout of this scene, because whatever fallout that's happening here is going to also negatively impact this child, Ryan. And none of what's happening is Ryan's fault. He has not committed international war crimes, so I still manage to have some empathy for him. But we'll see what happens in season 4, though. I don't feel great about where they're going. So let's get back to Maeve and her final hurrah on the show. When Homelander got her eye, I will admit that my first reaction was, ooh, are we getting eye patch Maeve now? I know she will wear the absolute hell out of an eye patch. But the way she had that slow motion sequence of taking in what was happening, of seeing that Ryan was in danger, and then grabbing this war criminal about to blow up and tackling him out the window, I firmly believe that I can simultaneously take issue with how underused Maeve was in this season's story, but also I can love this ending because she was really losing her faith in the idea of being heroic and of doing the right thing for the good of the people at large, and then she proves that ultimately she is a hero. I did think that she wasn't going to survive when she first jumped out the window because they had already shown that Black Noir was killed off, so I thought it was just going to be a season finale of a lot of carnage. But when they revealed that she was still alive, I was very happy about that decision because it was an important subversion of the bury your gaze trope. You have literally one lead character in this ensemble who is not straight, and it's Maeve. So you would have been falling into that trope if you had chosen to kill her off. But instead, she gets to escape this cage that she's been locked in for several years, Vought. And you have to remember, she was already a long-standing prisoner of Vought by the time we saw the very first episode of the show. And now she is free to live a cute, quiet life with Elena on a farm. I do think there is room to bring her back, like I said, if the story calls for it. But even though I like Maeve as a character, I have to keep reiterating that it's important for her to go now because the creative team of this show demonstrated that they did not have a better vision for her character. If you had any good ideas, I would have said to keep her on the show, but you apparently don't, so it's goodbye, Maeve. Thank you for being a friend. And by the way, I absolutely love that they played Goodbye Yellow Brick Road as her goodbye song. I don't know if they chose it just because it works really well as a farewell song, since it's got goodbye in the title, but if you don't already know this, The Wizard of Oz is a film with a pretty strong historical legacy for the LGBT community. If you go looking for articles about it, there's this very prominent narrative that the film was very popular for a lot of gay men who interpreted Dorothy's journey in such a way that they were really able to connect to it. And that went hand in hand with Judy Garland becoming a gay icon, not just for being a fabulous, musically talented diva, but because of how much she openly embraced her gay fans during an even more socially and politically regressive time for that community. So it just felt like a very appropriate musical choice. And I love Judy Garland. She is a true icon, and I welcome any way of further incorporating and referencing her into any film or show that I'm watching. I love that Annie threw away her outfit because she doesn't need it to be a hero. Although, if I were her, I would have burned it. I don't know why she just threw it away. Someone's definitely going to find that. But of course, the final point to talk about is the rally. We all saw what happened. Homelander lasered a protester who threw something that hit Ryan, and Todd, who is the worst, started cheering for Homelander, and then all the rest of his stands started cheering too. I think that part of the storyline feels inspired by that recurring thing I heard being mentioned in political discourse where people would talk about how, oh, 45 stands or so into him, that he could kill someone and they would still love him. It also follows the storyline they've already established, which is that Homelander is desperate to be loved, or at least his twisted version of love. But what I find most intriguing about this development in the story, and also Ryan having that twisted smile of enjoying the praise, is that I have a suspicion that this is setting up a story about the parasocial relationships we see happening a lot more nowadays, especially with a lot of online influencers. So I make videos for YouTube as a platform, and I've definitely seen my fair share of stories reported within the YouTube ecosystem about the exploitation of children in the genres such as family vloggers, family channels, kids channels. The main takeaway of all of those scandals being that Children should not be thrust into the spotlight. But to be clear, you don't even need to be familiar with YouTube drama to understand that idea. You can just think about any number of horror stories about what happens to child actors in show business. There is a lot of material to work from, and you've already set up the contrast between Homelander and Ryan to MM being a father who speaks candidly about intergenerational trauma within his family to his daughter. Meanwhile, Homelander is about to turn Ryan into a monster. I do hope that Ryan can be saved, though, because I don't want them to set up a child actor to get a barrage of hate sent his way when the character spirals into villainy because his father is a fascist. The masses have already shown that they don't know how to act right when it comes to child actors. Just ask Jake Lloyd about that. But yes, overall, a really strong season finale. It is sad to see Maeve and Black Noir go, but like I said, it was a necessary move since the ensemble was far too crowded. Thank you to everyone that's been following along with my reviews of The Boys season 3, and feel free to stick around since I will be trying to do one or two more videos about the show in the next week before I head to Southern California for Comic-Con. Don't forget to subscribe and let me know what you thought of this season finale, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.